The Restless Midlifer Podcast. Get health, weight, and life back on your terms. Hi, welcome to episode 99 of the podcast. We're almost at 100, and next week I have a special episode just to celebrate that fact and have a load of guests, past guests from previous episodes, coming along to share 1 to 2 minutes food for thought, a tip, an idea, a reflection, a challenge, something that you can take away for the week and consider to mull over, etc. And for me, it's a chance to celebrate and acknowledge the fact that we've made it to 100 episodes. And hopefully there'll be a lot more than that, maybe 200, 300, 400, who knows. But for now, that's the landmark. So looking forward to that one. This week, I'm going to share with you a food for thought around the challenge of knowing what to do, but not doing it when it comes to health goals, etc. And I'll come on to that very shortly. But we've got a great interview today with a friend of mine who I've known for a lot of years, Stu McGivern. Now, Stu has a great wealth of experience and a really down-to-earth approach and view on life and work. And we explore a number of things. We explore, you know, Stu's story in terms of growing up and the work that he's done and how he approaches it, and share some real nuggets of wisdom there. But we also explore a health challenge and the fact that Stu at a particular time had a heart attack a number of years ago, and the lessons learned, if you like, from that, and the things that he wants to share around that, I think is really important. So I won't steal the thunder of the interview. Great interview. Check it out. And let me know your thoughts at dave@restlessmidlifer.com for that. But for now, my food for thought. I know what I need to do. I'm just not doing it. Now, that's something that I've done myself and found myself saying to myself so many times. And it's something I've come across in lots of conversations, whether it's with prospective clients or coaching clients as we're working through the journey. This is such a common thing because I think, and it gets down to the essence really of how I approach supporting my clients and working with people, is that I think most of the time we know really what the essence of what we need to do is. You know, there's a lot of information out there about diets, this, exercise, that, etc. But when it comes down to it, most of us have a grasp of the basics and the core. And therein lies the challenge, because we have the grasp of the basics. So why are we not doing it? Now, this is the thing, because the challenge is that we beat ourselves up. We start to criticize ourselves and we start to get really hard on ourselves for not doing what is blindingly obvious or what everybody else says I should do, or somebody such and such seems to be doing really well. But what I want to sort of highlight is that that is such a common phenomenon. I know what to do, so why aren't I doing it? And for me, it's the what's wrong with me fallacy. That idea that it's me that's wrong. I'm wrong because it works for such and such. It works over there. Everybody else seems to be doing it right, but me. That is a fallacy, because the problem is everybody is in an individual situation, and those that are successful haven't taken something lifted straight off a book, I'm pretty confident, and translated it into their life. They've tweaked, they've changed, they've found what worked, and they've probably made some key decisions about what other things to drop. And in order to prioritize, they've made some difficult decisions. The challenge that we have, or that any one of us have in this position, is how do we step away from that self-damage, that self-criticism that is getting in the way? Because it's noise. It's noise in the system again. That self-sabotage is getting in the way of us working out and working on what really we need to do. So here's the thing. When I talk about self-compassion, I'm not talking about something fluffy. When I'm talking about being kind to yourself, I'm not talking about being soft on yourself. What I'm talking about is a pragmatic approach to getting rid of the things that get in the way of you getting to where you want to go in relation to your goal or goals. Because one thing that is sure, self-sabotage, self-criticism, the cruelty that we can push and direct at ourselves does not help. It gets in the way. In fact, it does more than not help. It hinders, it undermines, it breaks and eats away at your resolve, your motivation, and anything, any sort of inclination you have to work towards a goal. So that self-sabotage that arises out of what's wrong with me? Why am I the only one who's going to get it right? I know what to do. Why am I not doing it? That self-sabotage is a problem that gets in the way. So self-compassion and kindness, yes, it is nice, it's good, it's really important, but it's not soft and fluffy. It's essential that we park it to then get on with what we need to do. So if you find yourself asking that question, you know, what's wrong with me? Everybody else seems to be getting it right. Oh, I know what to do. I'm just not doing it. I try, but it's not happening. If you find yourself asking those kinds of questions, then what I want you to do is start to flag those questions with yourself. Flag the self-sabotage, self-cabotage as I call it, with yourself so that you start to realize and catch yourself in the act. The challenge is that we do a lot of this unconsciously or subconsciously without even consciously noticing or thinking it. It grinds away at us without us noticing. And what we need to do is flag that so that we see that as a signal and a sign that we are doing things that are getting in the way of where we want to go. If we strip away all the fancy stuff, the fluffy stuff, that's the bottom line. Self-sabotage, these kinds of questions get in the way of moving to where you want to go in relation to your goal. So if you can use that to catch yourself, the next thing is then to start to work out, okay, so what is going on that is leading to me not being able to move in the direction of my goal or to carry out the things I know I can do or need to do? Because that's a better answer. That's a better question, rather. The challenge is, or the reality is, that everything we do makes complete and utter sense if we step back and take a look at the context of your life, the things that you are juggling and doing, the work that you're taking on, the things that you're not saying no to, the things that you are feeling obliged to out of a people-pleasing drive, whatever it is. It makes perfect sense when you step back and look at the big picture of what you are juggling. If you imagine the cabbages that you're carrying around, all those demands, the internal and the external, all of those things are weighing us down. But more than that, they're draining us of energy, they're sapping our motivation and distracting you from moving towards the goal. So that's the key part, is to use those as a flag to then recognize the context of your life. And once you can spot, right, where am I expending my energy? Because you are strong. You've been strong and incredibly strong for a long, long time. The challenge is using that strength in the right direction to the right extent. So it's about looking at, what do I need to put down? What do I need to stop doing? And start focusing on that rather than focusing on the goal. Because often when we start to just look at, right, what am I taking on? Do I have to really be doing that? Why am I doing this? And is it because I always do it or always have done? Or is it being driven by that people-pleasing need? Because any of those drivers need a little bit of attention. And it's not about all or nothing. If it's about backing out of a commitment in an honourable and an ethical way, then that's okay to do. And it might take a little bit of time. You might have to fulfil something. But it's about learning to say no, or to at least delay saying yes until you've had a chance to rationally think. So there's a lot in this, but what I wanted to do was focus on that question that we tend to ask ourselves, or the punishment we mete out to ourselves when we find that we're not doing what we know we need to do. It's okay. Permission to be human. It's because there will be some other reasons within the context of our life. So I'll use those as the thing to signal it. You then take a look at the context of your life and look for an opportunity. One thing you can put down, one thing you can do to recharge your batteries, one commitment you might be able to step away from, something like that, within that, to give yourself the space to then build in the things you believe or know you need to do in small sprout-sized chunks. Because again, there may be a lot that you need to do, but you don't need to do it all at once. We take one thing at a time, embed that and move it on. So that's the key thing for today. So have a think about that. Have a think about that phrase that you might ask yourself. How does that show up with you? Because I think most of us do know what we need to do. It's the challenge of doing it. And what we tend to do is beat ourselves up for not doing it. Instead of that, park that, give yourself a break, look at the context, see what you put down, and pick back up something small that moves you in the direction of your goal. So, hope you found that useful. Let me know any thoughts at dave@restlessmidlifer.com. But for now, on with the interview. Take care.
Okay, well, I'm Stuart. It's great to have you along. And I know we've been talking about this for a little while, so it's good to have you in conversation. Do you want to tell the listeners a bit about yourself, and then we'll get into some of the things that I want to touch on with you?
Yeah. Thank you for having me on, Dave. We have spoke before, but normally on the phone, so thank you very much for having me. I'm a 58-year-old guy from Gateshead, East Gateshead to be precise. And I've got three grown-up daughters. I've been working since 1980, started when I was 16. So I've been working, this is my 43rd year of work. I've always worked in the Northeast, which is like sort of like my favourite place.
Yeah.
I've done a little bit of travelling with work, European travel, been to Japan, stuff like that. Spent a lot of my time around automotive, although there was a little life before automotive. I'm working with automotive now. I'm not actually in automotive, but I'm supporting automotive. I'm a guy that's always sort of worked. I know quite a lot of people in the industry, and I've worked at the RDA, Nissan, Clark Chapman's. I've worked at Crabtree of Gateshead. I've worked for a consultancy. I've worked for myself. I've worked for a cluster. So I've had quite a bit of a varied sort of life so far. Continue.
Yeah, and I think we met, I can't remember how many years, it was 10 plus years, something like that ago when...
quite a while back, yeah.
Your consultancy then, if I remember rightly, would that be about right? You were...
I came out of working for a company called PA Consultant, who were running the project in the Northeast, the Mars Northeast project, and... I decided to have a go at my own business with a good friend of mine, Barry Rogerson, another good guy, Tim Cummins. We got together and we tried to do an innovative and tailored productivity solutions. That's what we used to do. But I was a bit of an anti-consultant, to be honest with you. I used to turn up in my old car and, you know, like, I wasn't really what I'd call a consultant. I'd say to people, well, you know, if we can't help you doing that. And then they wanted us to help them even more, which is strange, isn't it? When you're sort of honest with people, say, this isn't really our bag, but we can have a look at it if you want to. Oh, I'd love you to have a look at it. So it's a strange sort of thing, you know. We turned down quite a lot of work for reasons that it just didn't feel right or it wasn't really the right thing to do. So we're quite... Consultants get a bad name, but I think we're pretty fair, you know. We're okay, you know. But a lot of local companies helped us, and I'm very grateful for that. I still keep in touch with people now who did help us, you know.
Yeah, because I think you're right in terms of consultants. It gets a bad name, but you know, over the years now in business, particularly having met lots, the vast majority, not all, but the vast majority of experience, got a lot to offer and work really well with clients in whatever. I think what you said there is about sometimes when you set up in business, sometimes if you're not clear about what you can and can't do, what you can offer or will offer,
yeah,
then you can sometimes take on work that isn't really in your wheelhouse because you feel like you need the work. So I think that's an important point, isn't it? You know,
I mean, the best thing I ever done was sit down with a guy called Zainal Baddock, who's a good friend of mine. And he sat down and basically we come up with what was on the back of a business card. And it took me 3 days to do that. You know, what do you actually do? Which sounds really sort of like an easy thing. But when you start looking at it, we come up with innovative and tailored productivity solutions. So if it wasn't innovative and it wasn't tailored to you, and it wasn't linked to productivity, we normally used to say, well, we don't do that.
Yeah.
Not to say we didn't end up doing other stuff if people want us to, but we had a very clear mindset of what we'd done and who we wanted to work with. And it's amazing how many people I meet in business who, you know, who haven't got that one liner on in the back of the card. You know, what do you do? And it's a great way of just really thinking about what you are, you know, to the marketplace, or to the marketplace, who you are, and what do you want to do, you know?
I think
it's interesting.
Yeah, it is. I think it's, I mean, there's a lot of people, you know, in terms of business, a lot of people setting up businesses and starting businesses at any given time, aren't there? And there's obviously the failure rates are quite high. But for me, as that midlifer, I think many people who are in work start to think about things like, how do I get out of this? And perhaps setting up a business can feel like the right thing. But I think you're right. It's that, well, okay, yes, it might be part of the escape plan, but exactly what is it? What am I trying to achieve? All of that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah. And to be honest, it also depends on who you set up with and what you've got. I mean, I had to, McGivern Limited had to bring a certain amount of money in. Probably a bit like Aljo Limited.
Yes.
And if you don't bring that amount of money in, it can be very, very difficult. And I think that's why after 3.5 years, which I would encourage anybody to do it if they can do it.
Right.
Because you learn a lot. It's like doing a degree. You know, that 3.5 years was like doing a degree, learning about business, but learning about myself. But I needed more cash. Not that I'm a greedy guy. It's just I had three daughters all getting to university kind of level. Your hands never out your pocket. And I needed an amount of money. But then I needed a job that gave us a bit of flexibility and allowed me to do what I do. And I think the job I'm doing now gives me that flexibility to in the interest, which is wonderful. But if you've worked for yourself and then you suddenly go back into the mainstream working job market and you get a pay every month, it's wonderful. It's wonderful. Yeah. And I would recommend that. You know, when people are saying, I'm having a bad day or I'm having a bad week or I hate my bloody job, go and work for yourself for a while. And after 3.5 years, you might go, wow, every month I get paid. Isn't this wonderful? So there you go. So that's one of the learning things that I would encourage people to do. But I think there's probably a lot of companies out there. You know, I meet a lot of people, I think, well, I don't get what you're doing. Maybe it's because I'm a baby boomer. Maybe it's because I'm wired in a different way. But if people can't really articulate what they do very quickly, it's gone. Mm. You know, it's gone. You only get a couple of chances.
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes people say things, you know, what did they actually just say? I don't understand what they're saying. So if I don't understand what they're saying, I really am getting up. Or they're not explaining themselves properly, or something else.
Yeah. So, you know, there's a couple of transitions there. I mean, you were in work and then you set up a business. What prompted you to move into business? Because this is a challenge I think many have, certainly from my perspective, when I was in the police. I kind of realised after about 7 years, this isn't for me. What am I going to do? And the business idea, or not the business, the idea of the business, but having a business had always appealed to me right from college days when we had to set one up in our BTEC HND, it was. We had a sort of business. So we set up one selling boxer shorts on the marketplace when we were 15. Mm. You know?
Yeah.
And it always stuck with me, this idea of, oh, I would like to do it. But doing it, as you say, moving from something secure, well-paid, that, you know, almost handcuffs you in, to the uncertainty was a biggie. And I was a lot naive, let's be right, particularly the first time around. What about you? What was your decision process? Because I think for many, it's how I'm feeling trapped or crushed or lost in my life or a bit of direction. It doesn't always mean it's the job's fault or the job's issue. There's lots of other things. But often that's where people will look and think, right, I want something more.
Mm.
But the security can often tie you in or make you feel as if you're tied in.
Mm. I've been very lucky to have to move jobs. And when I was at Nissan, I moved jobs every 3 years, and I've got loads of experience there. Yeah. You know, great business from a learning perspective. But when you're talking about transitioning to working for myself, one of my philosophies is the difference between a good job and a bad job is who you report into.
Right, yeah.
You can have a really crap job and a great boss, and it's great.
Yeah.
But you can have a really great job and a bad boss, and it's hard work. So I would say I've come across many different kinds of working practices. When I worked for a large consultancy, maybe times have changed, but in those days it was remuneration was everything.
Hmm.
You know, you spent lots of time talking about bonuses. It bored me to death. Bored me to death. Everybody's on a bell curve. You've got to get rid of 10% of the staff, or 10% of the staff. You've got to go through this sort of, like, you know, process of potentially losing the jobs. And just didn't like it at all, to be honest with you. It just didn't really appeal to my sense of fairness or anything. So I thought, well, this isn't for me. And I ended up doing that because the project I was working for got transferred over to a consultancy. And, you know, don't get me wrong, they've done everything that they needed to do for employees, but it was just, that was it. Everything was about money. The change in some people I worked with was unbelievable when we started talking about bonuses. I remember going to the first meeting, and there's only a couple who said, we don't want to work with a bonus scheme. Right. I didn't want to work with a bonus scheme. I don't like them. I think they encourage the wrong kind of behavior, and it ends up in a bun fight. So I knew I didn't want to go down the big the big consultancy route. But then I thought, okay, I was in the management team, and I thought, well, I'm gonna leave the management team for a year, and I'm gonna build my network back up with an idea to go on my own. And the reason I wanted to go on my own was primarily just to try it. Right. And it's strange, and I don't know whether it's there's loads of books on attraction, you know, power of attraction and serendipity and all this kind of stuff. But the guy who I ended up working with the most, I remember I told him 11 years before, I said, I'll end up working with you.
Yeah.
And it just so happens he was one of the other people that put his hand up and said, I don't like bonus schemes. Mm. So between we were trying to do the right thing. And different sort of backgrounds. He didn't have any children or, you know, for whatever reason, but he didn't have that financial problem I did. And all these things come out when you're working with him. But I still keep in touch with him. He's a great guy called Barry Rogerson. And he's a great guy and very clever bloke. So we could, between, we're both trained to the same sort of level when I'd done continuous improvement for the RDA. But he was an engineer. I mean, I'm not an engineer. I'm a guy that has worked in commercial who sort of done productivity. And then I'd done some proper good quality productivity training. Mm. But he's a proper engineer. And I think the word engineer is a word that people just use now. And they go, I'm an engineer. I'm not sure you are, you know? You know, the time served, experiential, analytical, problem solving engineer. They're worth their weight in gold when you're trying to solve a problem, you know.
Yeah.
Plus he used to love his licorice paper rollies, you know. So we'd go to these jobs and he'd say, I'm away for a smoke, and we'd be sitting there with our heads in our hands saying, well, how are we gonna solve this? It's like a ritual, some kind of like samurai ritual, you know. He's sort of like molding the cigarette, and he's seen about 10 minutes, and he'd always come back with an answer. It was if he cleared his head.
Yeah.
And he'd come back. And plus, he also used to smoke in the smoking place with everybody who were on the shop floor who really know what's going on. And the intel he used to get was unbelievable. So these kind of, you couldn't imagine a consultant just sort of like, so I'm going to roll a cigarette and have it, you know, sit outside and talk to the lads and lasses. Yeah. So that's the kind of sort of stamp he was. So it was to try it out, to see what it was like. And I would say on the whole, very enjoyable, very enjoyable.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? I think this is the thing about many of us. We go through life, perhaps fall into jobs and roles. I certainly bimbled, I like to use that word, bimble, into the police. Bimbled into the job because I didn't know what I wanted to do.
I still don't know what I want to do.
Right, exactly. I'm not sure I want to grow up, but I'm still working on it. But I think that you often put these things to one side, the running of the business for me, playing an instrument, being this, doing whatever they are. And I think it's the opportunities then to sort of say, right, well, do I do this and do a follow-up? And from your perspective, you've done it, then you went back to employment, but you've tried. I mean, what was the worst that could happen? Well, you went back and got a job, but you gained so much from that period of time that it helped your ear shape the kind of job you were, as in shape what you wanted from a job.
Yeah.
Also, you had a lot of learning to bring to it, I guess.
The job I'm doing now is a very unique job. It didn't exist until 2015 when they set up the Northeast Automotive Alliance. And I've spent some time at Nissan, then I've done a lot of other stuff. So it's like a quite a unique job because no week's the same. I deal with big companies, I deal with small companies, I deal with people like Nissan. And I just went to see a little company called I'll put a plug in for Reg Morton at Acer. He's got Acer Design and he's got some engineering kind of establishment. I went to see him today, and those are the kind of people when you meet, although you get a lot of intel from the big boys, the real grassroots stuff's really interesting. I like working with SMEs and trying to help them just shape an idea of what they want to do, or if they've got a problem, can we help them fix it? Or if they want to route to market, can we help them establish it? So it's sort of it's a bit like a very interesting knowledge kind of role I've got. I'm very, very blessed to have it, to be fair, because it doesn't exist anywhere else.
Yeah. I mean, there's always an element. Look, but it's kind of being in it to win it, isn't it? You make your luck, you kind of get into, you give the business a go, then you look around and you think. And for me, that you talk about the monthly pay, that was the biggest thing, because I left the police twice. First time, when the 15th of the month came around and nothing dropped into my account, I knew that that was wasn't going to happen, but it was still a strange feeling. And then a year, the most stressful of my life, really had to face facts and go back. So I went back to police and part time then.
Thank you.
And boy, did I really appreciate that. I mean, you gradually over the years, because I was shaping the business, I realized this is why I left, because it's not me and stuff. But what kept me probably a bit longer was the comfort of that wage. And I'm not knocking it, because it was really important at the time, you know, to pay that as I built the business up. But yeah, I certainly appreciated that. So I my second time of leaving, it was the final, right, I'm not going back, etc. But I did it, I feel like I did it better the second time around.
Right. Are you from a family of policemen?
No. I bimbled into it. It was one of those where I was in a marketing job that, again, I kind of got because I thought, well, I've done a business qualification, I'll just do that, and was pretty bored stupid, to be fair, and I was looking at anything. And police occurred to me one day. I said to me, "Mum, I think I'll join the police or apply to join the police." And she said, "Well, you lose all your friends." And that was it. Joined and didn't lose all my friends. Gained some great ones as well. And obviously the rest is history.
Yeah, I'll sidetrack a little bit, but there was a guy who was like a father figure to me called Michael Dunning. And he's 6'6" high, and lived in the council estate, the police houses up in Liam Lane, where I'm from. Middle of the miners' strike, he could still stand in the local boozer and have a pint. When, you know, it was quite an interesting time that when, you know, he was part of the community and the community actually respected him.
Yeah.
And that's just that I don't know whether it's the working class thing or we're all in it together, but we're actually all rolling it together. And by the way, this guy is a policeman, but he's one of us because he lives with me. And he could write a book. He's, unfortunately, he's dead now, but he could write a book of some of the things he sorted out on the estate, on the QT, you know. And I just think, you know, the world's changed, hasn't it?
Oh yeah. I think that's one of the challenges, isn't it? Particularly with mental health and stuff, is the breakdown of traditional communities. Because their faults, but what they did have was a lot of social support, and really that was
protective. Massive.
Speaking of, I mean, one of the things that we've talked about, which I was surprised when you told me about it, shocked actually, was in terms of your health, you had you experienced heart attack a few years back. Would you mind just sharing that? Because for me, this comes with the midlife thing. When we start to look at, is this it? This what I'm working for? you have to kind of take the positives with the negatives and look at the...
Hey, I'm work in progress, Dave. I'm work in progress, you know, like everybody else.
Yeah.
It's quite a strange one, because the reason I ended up doing... The reason I ended up going to day release at the time, when when you worked, you'd go to a night school or one night and a day release. And when my dad died at 17, when I was 17, he was 57. Totally destroyed me. You know, so I often think now these poor people who are involved in either conflicts or natural disasters, you know, that they say, oh, well, it's 39,000, I don't know what it is in Turkey now, 40,000 people have died. But you've got so many survivors who've maybe lost the key breadwinner. And that is a mental trauma that you never, ever get over. You learn to accept it. You know, but you don't get over it. So that started. So from a very young age, I knew very, very young, you know, very, very young, that I thought, all right, nothing lasts forever. My best mate's gone. What am I going to do now? My mother's, losing her mind, and my brother's going off the rails. Well, welcome to my world. But as things, as you sort of, you know, get into life and do one thing, blah, 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 suddenly you're in your 50s. And I was 56. And I had what they call a widowmaker heart attack. It's got that name for a reason. And it's the wrong blockage in the wrong artery, which is a big artery. It's the left anterior descending artery. I know that because I've researched the subject, because that's the way I think. I like to understand the details. And at wrong place, wrong time. Depends where you look on facts. It's got a 6% survival rate. If you're out of a hospital setting, it can rise to 20%. If you're in a hospital setting, and I survived by basically saying to my wife, I'm having a heart attack, you need to ring 999. And it was in COVID.
Right.
And I thought, oh, this is it. And I was actually very calm. I was more calm then than I am now, talking to you. It was like a fatalistic attitude. I was sitting there thinking, oh, well, if this is it, oh, wow, on my own in an ambulance. Wow. And everybody just keeps saying, you look well. And I said, I don't feel well. And everybody just keeps saying, you look well. They were actually observers in case I crash. I didn't realize that at the time. Then finally, this Geordie fella in a van, he says, don't worry, buddy, lad. If you die in the van, I'll bring you back to life. And that's when I started really getting worried, because he'd sort of like done what he needed to do with the ECG. He thought, oh my God. And then it was just like a pit stop at the Freeman. Absolutely, you know, you see pit stops, and you know, you do see a lot of changeovers on machines on shop floors. It was the best organization I've seen. Although I did have a little bit of morphine in it. I was like, you know, arm down, bang, who are you? Bang, who are you? Blah, 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 right? Bang, you're done. And do you want to see what we've done? Yeah, no blood flow. I went, oh, thank you very much. Dispatch you to a little room, and then everybody's dead happy. It's called survival's euphoria.
All right.
Loads of old blokes in the room going, "Way, we'll survive. It was just a crazy couple of days. I should have wrote a comedy sketch about it. I was in for 2 days, and you've got all these really happy people because they've survived. And they're living on the nerves a bit. It's like that. So I was very, very lucky. And I'm still dealing with that, to be honest with you. Because I didn't see it coming. The cardiologist said, genetics is number one, lifestyle is number two. You've probably had, your father probably had the same, but you don't smoke, and three of your other arteries are clear. Well done. But they just dispatch you like you've had a tooth out.
Right. Yeah.
You know, it's like, oh, well, you could have died. See you. And that's the problem. You go about and you go, I think I had 2 weeks off work and I still have my moments where I'm going, bloody hell, this is a bit mad. Because then they put you on a standard medication, you know, for everybody.
Yeah.
You know, whether you're big, small, male, female, whatever, you get the standard amount of tablets. So I'm probably struggling at the moment with the tablets I'm on. I need to probably, I'm due a review. And they sort of slow you down a bit and that. But I'm drumming tonight in the band. So I'm still feeling a bit tired, but I'm still trying to do me drumming and that. So it, I'm a very lucky man. I'm a very blessed man. And although it's work in progress. So I think anybody who's had a heart attack will tell you that it's not, you know, you don't just have a heart attack. And, you know, it you've got to live with it. You've got to conquer it. You've got to be aware of it. You've got to accept it. And that's in your 50s. It's like the research I've done is, it's like, you know, you get to a certain age in a developed country, but there's a massive spike in the 50 to 60 with blokes.
Right.
Massive.
Right.
So if you can survive that 50 to 60, you've got a good chance.
Right.
So it's like a real spike.
Yeah. What is it then, do you think, that you said it, obviously you had no warning, no clue. It was just, you know, it happened. I mean, you said the doctor said genetic, lifestyle, etc. But is there that something about that period of life for many of us, do you think?
I think in your 50s, right? Let's be honest. You know, you don't see many 50-year-old cars on the road, do you? And when you think of what your body does,
yeah,
even the heart, you know, the amount of blood it pumps and everything, you know, and you just look at your lifestyle. Whether you've had a, I mean, you, people go, well, I've had a healthy lifestyle. Ah, right, okay. So you never went out on a weekend, right? Okay. Oh, I did. Ah, you never had that kebab. Oh, yeah, I did. Ah, right, okay. You didn't have that big meal. All right, I did. Right, and when you start, it builds up over time. You know, the whole thing, you don't, the start of a heart attack, you've got to be careful with heart attacks because most people have got the wrong information. You know, it's a coronary. It's a blocking of the arteries. Right. It's called a heart attack. It should be called a blocking of the arteries attack.
Right.
It's not wrong with a heart.
Right.
It's the pipe work and oxygen to a heart. But that builds up from your teenage years.
Yeah.
So it's you can be fit in your 50s, no two ways about it. But chances are, if you're brought up in the northeast of England or in a Western society, you'll have plaque on your arteries.
Mm.
In the same way, you might have grey hair, you know, in the same way that, you know, like other things, you might have a bad knee because you've done so much sport or whatever. It is part and parcel of it, but it's a bit of a shock, you know.
Yeah, and I think that's part of it, because the conversation you actually prompted me, and it was a conversation with you and a friend of mine from the CrossFit, Dave, who's actually been on the podcast as well, that prompted me to get me numbers done. You know, the last time we had a conversation, and actually they came in because, and I guess this is one of the things, because what we want is, I don't want to terrify people or get people really afraid about this. You know, age is what it is. It brings a lot of positives as well as the downside to aging. But it's about awareness and just not burying our head in the sand. You know, so are there things we can do just in advance right now, just to sort of get some checks, to get our head into what I might need to do to support my health going forward, you know?
Blokes are notorious at not going to the doctors. I've always went to the doctors. So one of the positive effects, my dad's, I had a bit of a laugh one time. I went to the Felon Health Centre down in Felon, or the Felon, if you're from the Felon. It's the Felon, you drop the G. And I went to the Healthy Man Clinic. And the Healthy Man Clinic was like, you know, you went and got your bloods done, and I always knew I had higher cholesterol.
Mm.
So, you know, kept an eye on it and diet, weight. And then I turned up one day and I went, oh, I'm sorry, Stu, but you can't come anymore. So why are you the only one coming? You're the only bloke that comes to the healthy man for me. For the shortest.
Right.
So that tells you everything you want to know about the way men look at their health. And then they play Russian roulette with tablets. So you get on a tablet. Oh, well, I can have that kebab now. I'm on a statin.
Yeah.
New.
Hmm.
You know, or I'm on this tablet. Oh, great, I can do this. It's the whole sort of awareness piece and understanding piece. And most people don't really want to go there.
Yeah.
I've got friends who have smoked since they were 14. They haven't had a heart attack. How do you think that makes me feel? You know, and they've drank like fish and still do. I don't want the guy to have a heart attack. He's a great mate of mine. I love him very much. But you just think, bloody hell, what's going on? Yeah, like, you know.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. That's the genetic piece. So you've just got to be aware that, I would encourage anybody to, if you've got any kind of that kind of thing in your family history, then you owe it to yourself.
Yeah.
To do something. Yeah. Because it's not a surprise. You know, you are a function of your mom and dad.
Mm.
You know, your dad probably wasn't Arnold Schwarzenegger. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We're just normal people doing normal things, eating normal stuff, and that's the way it is. But yeah, genetics has got a lot to play in it. I feel like I've been, I felt very, very sad for a while, saying, this is not really right. But then the cardiologist said, well, your lifestyle saved you.
Right. Yeah.
So that would be what I'd say to people. Just get up and do something. I mean, we do condition monitoring on machines. You know, you put sensors all over machines, you know, in the automotive industry, see how efficient they are. Just do a bit of condition monitoring on yourself.
Yeah, I think, I mean, this part of it, I suppose this is the public service announcement part of this. To the doctors, whether you want to or not, whether you're... you talk about blokes, and I think you're right. I think typically, because I was brought up to not bother the doctor unless you had five things. You know, you collect a few things before the doctor. Now they make you make an appointment for each one now, but... which I understand because they've gone and blocked time. But I also, know from talking to people that a couple of female clients who also struggle like when they feel like there's something not right to face the fear. And part of that is how do you know, obviously negotiating that, but accepting that the knowledge is the important bit, the awareness and just getting the facts, know where you stand, and then you can. You've got options then if you've got a bit of knowledge, haven't you? So for me, that's a public service announcement part of the podcast.
I didn't really, I mean, I'm happy to talk about it, so, yeah. But I haven't really said much to anybody apart from me close, people I work with and that, that's, I haven't made a big announcement on LinkedIn, blah, blah, blah. But at the end of the day, I just think... it's very important. I think that it's intertwined. Getting older is intertwined with your mental health.
Mm.
You know, it's accepting the unacceptable.
Mm.
That's what, I heard of a guy called Eckhart Tolle. He wrote The Power of Now. He's great. Great guy. You've got to accept the unacceptable.
That's a very,
There's
a statement, because I think you're right. I've touched on a little bit of his stuff, but not read anything deeply. But that is an important statement, actually.
Mm.
The unacceptable is something that, as a young'un, you kind of can, to an extent, deny or ignore. You know, you have heavy weekends, you have a hangover a day,
or you
bounce back. There's a lot of bouncing back from these things, and the body, mind, whatever, is very forgiving. But as you get to certain decades in life, it doesn't get quite so elastic or springy, does it?
No. I think it's about, for me, as I said, I'm work in progress. Every day, a good friend of mine, And he's a great guy. And I've only known him about 5 years. And he said to me, Stu, he says, do something for yourself every day.
Mm.
Whatever that is. Whatever that is. Mm. Do something for somebody else every day.
Right.
And do something for society every day.
Oh, right.
And right. I thought, what the bloody hell do you mean by that? And because I go on walks. Yeah. Very few of my mates want to go on a walk. They all want to go on they'd love to go on a beer for a long, you know, a big long beer session, but they don't want to go on a walk.
Yeah.
So I tend to, I've migrated to people who like to go on walks.
Yeah.
So he said, well, take this for example. We're going for a walk. You see that old, you see that milk bottle that's blown out the bin that we've delivered, you know, the recyclable stuff on there. It blew out of the bin. We'll pick that up and we'll put it in the bin. So we're out doing a walk, which is something for myself, and we're picking something up. Not that you're not being a womble, you know. That I'm not saying you go around picking everything up. Although there is some wardly wombles where I live, they do a bloody good job. A lot of them are retired, etc. But just do something like that, and even if you're feeling like SHT, still try and do something for somebody.
I like that. I like
that. Just do something for somebody. Do something for yourself, though.
Mm.
So that could be, I don't know, it could be go for a walk, or it could be treat yourself to a 10 minute relaxation thing, or just stop doing what you're doing. Because this working from home thing's just knackered everybody. Absolutely everybody. When I used to look at productivity in offices, you know what I'd budget for work in an office?
No.
4 hours.
Right, yeah.
You know, somebody's brought the cakes in, somebody's having a party, you're up and down making cups of tea, somebody gets sidetracked. But from those sidetracks come magic moments of synergy.
Oh.
I was talking to a bloke the other day, we remain nameless because I'm getting recorded. And I had a long discussion about him that he couldn't get away from his computer. He was stuck to his computer. He was waiting for a response because he works from home now. I said, stop that. Stop that. No, that's the wrong way. And I was working crazy before I had my heart attack with this magnet called a computer.
Yes, yeah.
So you know, draws you back. Things that would never bother you. Did they read my email?
Yeah.
Let's find out, you know. Wouldn't have bothered before it becomes polarized. That hasn't helped people. That hasn't helped people's well-being, blah, blah, blah. So the other bit of advice is if you're in your 50s working from home, you're a knowledge worker, you're paid for what you know, you're an experienced person, you know. You're not in a call center. It might look like a call center. Nothing wrong with call centers. But you're not like bang, 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 bang. That's not what it's about. It's effectiveness rather than busyness.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you're right, because the fact that it's in the home as well, it's there, it's easy. And you don't switch off. And I think, you know, I like that approach of the do one thing for yourself, one thing for somebody else, and then something for society. That's a nice
not my idea.
Oh, yeah, but a brilliant way to think about it. And one of the things you mentioned, which is, again, what we're talking about, was that you took up the drumming again. Or you took up
The first thing was I started drumming at 45. Again, another one of these crazy moments. My boss at the time, a couple of years before, he said, would you like to do a PhD? And I said, no. He says, what would you like to do? I said, I'd like to play drums. That was an interesting discussion. Stopped it in its tracks. Do you know what I mean? Stopped the conversation in its tracks. And I wanted to play this boozer in Felon, which is renowned for its music. It's shut now. It's called the Duke of Cumberland. I wanted to play that bar. It was like one of these, like, one day I will play that bar and I will be in a band. So I started drumming at 45. So I was pretty fit, you know. You've got to be pretty fit to be rocking drums out. If you've got any drumming mates, anybody listens to this, it's not for the faint-hearted, like.
It isn't.
You know, it's not for the... That's another reason why I thought, bloody hell, have I had a heart attack? What would have happened if I had a heart attack at the at the last song at the end of the gig, I would have went out like a blue light, you know. Do you know what I mean? Like, boom, that's the end of the gig and the end of me. But I was, you know, but at the end of the day, I love the drumming. And I do a bit of lyrics and stuff like that. So it's, you know, it gives you that aspects of stuff. But I love the drummers, and I would encourage anybody to just, if they've got any kind of urge, bloody do it.
Yeah.
So I ended up playing that gig. I'm still playing drums. I still enjoy it. It's becoming bloody harder. I'm waiting for my leg brace to come from Amazon across the road, you know, because I've got a dodgy right knee, for that's my bass pedal.
Right.
Once I get strapped up, I'll be all right. But we'll be carrying us on at the drum kit before long. So I just don't know how long it's going to last, but I would certainly recommend it. It's great for your mental health.
Yeah. Great
for your mental health.
Yeah. It's so, drumming may not be your thing or somebody else's thing, but I think it's finding that thing that you want to do. For me, getting back to the guitar. You know, whatever it is, it's fine that it's making that time, because you said something, they'll have to carry me onto the drum kit. But I mean, at least this is the rocking chair test. You know, at least you can sit like in whatever decade, two decades time with the rocker, the blanket over your lap, looking back, rocking your chair, going, yeah, pleased with that. I'm pleased I went for that, rather than I wish I had.
I think knowing what I know now about drumming, and I'm not a great drummer by any stretch of the imagination, you got to start when you're about 7. not 45. I remember turning up and I said, do you get any middle-aged blokes who want to like learn the drum? Loads, mate. Loads. The drum shop in Washington.
Oh yeah.
And I thought, and I turned up, loads of people. But I stuck it out, you know, I tend to stick things out once I commit to something. But you know, very, 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 very good. Met some wonderful people, and some crackers as well. But you know, it's all part of the mix, you know. And we've got an EP out called Moral Famine. So there you go,
Moral
Famine, and it's good old fashioned sort of rock punk. Yeah. Let's have a go at the system, you know, Boris Johnson. All sorts of stuff like that, you know. Let's have a go at it. Let's call people out, you know. Let's make a noise.
Yeah.
You know? Intellectual punk, I call it.
I like that. No, I think
and some of the punk stuff's very intellectual. To be fair, yeah. It gets a bad name. A lot of it.
Yeah, I've listened to it. It's a good EP. Brilliant. Enjoyed it. Put it on the background while I was doing a bit of work.
Well, thanks very much. but again, just little things like that. You go, well, I enjoyed doing that in the recording studio. You know, it sounds great, but it's just wonderful. You know, just wonderful. Just don't know what else I'm going to do, but I'm still hanging on in there with the drums.
Yeah. And for me, this is what it's about. And this is one of the reasons to have a conversation with you was because the adventures you've had, I guess, in life and the health. We call it a blip, but you know that the health issue and the fact you're still here, you're still positive, you're bringing that kind of what I think of is the restless midlife spirit, that spirit of adventure and thinking, right, I'm going to do this and I want to do this and have a go. And for me, that's that tapping back into it. So I'm conscious of time, but it's been great to have a conversation. Really, I've taken a few things away from this, actually, as well. Firstly, I guess the public service announcement part is, again, is get yourself checked out, whatever it is. Get those bloods done. I know I did it, as I was saying, because you prompted me to do it. I had done it a few years back, which had prompted me on my own health journey because my cholesterol was really high, and had them done again. And thankfully, they're well down. They've dropped right down into safe areas because of a lot of work.
Oh, that's good. That's good.
No. I wasn't sure until our conversation prompted me going, you know what? It's years. It's about time I did. So that's my encouragement to do.
Well, that's good. That's excellent.
I like that idea of do something for yourself, do something for somebody else, and do something for society. I think that's a great approach. And find those things. Find those things that you look back on your rocking chair, you think, I'm glad I did that.
And if you're cheesed off, still try and do something good for somebody.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because, you know, don't take the mood with you.
Yeah,
because there's plenty to be miserable about at the minute. But try not to take the mood with you, even if you are having a bad day.
Yeah.
And if anybody wants any, if anybody, I'm a great believer in people helping people. So if anybody does see this, the contact is or whatever. If they've had a heart attack, or if they're not feeling great, or it's always good to chew the cud.
Yeah.
It's there's not enough of that at the minute for people in the 50 to 60. Particularly in the COVID thing, I've had, if it wasn't for my wife and great members of friends and stuff like that, you're really, really tough if you lived on your own and you've been through a crisis.
Yeah.
It's not nice,
No, I think you're right. I think it's time for these kinds of conversations, and then offer of, somebody does want to connect. And on that note, again, we'll put any contact details in the show notes, but if, how would somebody get in touch with you? Do you want them to get in touch through me, dave@restlessmidlifer.com, or?
Anywhere? Yeah, that's fine. Well, I'm on LinkedIn, happily if they see this and happily have a chat with them,
Cool. Well, brilliant. Well, thank you for your time, Stu. It's been brilliant.
Thanks, Stu.
Enjoyed the conversation. Some great pearlers in there as well. And thank you very much. So
I really appreciate it.
That's good. And thanks for your time as well. And listeners, any thoughts, any feedback or questions, give me a shout at dave@restlessmidlifer.com. You can hook up with Stu at LinkedIn as well. All the details will be in show notes. But for now, we'll catch you in the next episode. Take care.
Thanks very much. Take care. God bless. Yeah. Bye.
Thank you for listening. You'll find all show notes, links and resources mentioned at midlifereshape.com/podcast. And it would mean so much if you could spread the word to your fellow restless midlifers. Share the show and links. And if you aren't already, subscribe to the show in your podcast feed of choice. And one more thing. If you enjoy the show, it would be great if you could rate it by visiting midlifereshape.com/review. It would mean so much, and I may even give you a shout out in return. And a quick final thanks to production assistant Karen North of North VA, and for the music, which is called Silver Star by the awesome Logan Nicholson of Music for Makers at musicformakers.com. Take care for now, and don't forget, you really can reshape your midlife health and rekindle that spirit of adventure.